Hello and welcome back to the Tech Blackboard. Do you know there are six major types of Amazon EC2 instances? General purpose, compute optimized, memory optimized, accelerated computing, storage optimized, and finally HPC optimized. And friends, quite a handful of questions in AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam comes from this topic. So let's start today's session with the questions on various types of Amazon EC2 instances. And for today's session, I have collected 6 questions so that you are familiar with each type of Amazon EC2 instance and are well prepared for the exam. And yes, before I begin, for those who are coming from the Microsoft Azure background, then Amazon EC2 is the counterpart service for Azure Virtual Machines. So now let's get started. So here comes the very first question for today. Question number 31, part 5. It says, which Amazon EC2 instance type is ideal for high performance databases? Your options are memory optimized, storage optimized, general purpose, compute optimized, accelerated computing, and the last one is HPC optimized. And the correct answer for this question is, my friends, option A, memory optimized. So let me cover all the 6 questions on various types of Amazon EC2, and then I will share all the relevant documentation with you so that you can validate the answers and also do some further studies. So question number 32 says that which Amazon EC2 instance type balances compute, memory, and networking resources? All the 6 options given are exactly the same as previous question. So let's see the correct answer. The correct answer for this question is option C, general purpose. Quickly moving to the question number 33, it says which Amazon EC2 instance type is suitable for data warehousing applications? And are you able to guess the answer? Well, the correct answer for this question is option B, storage optimized. So friends, you don't have to maintain the same speed on which this video is going. You can very well read the question, read all the options, understand them, and read some documentation. I will anyway share the documentation in the question number 36, and then try to figure out the answer yourself and match it with the answer I have given. So now let's move on with the question number 34. It says that which Amazon EC2 instance type offers high performance processors? And once again, options are exactly the same. And this time, my friends, the correct answer is option D, compute optimized. Coming up next is question number 35 that says which Amazon EC2 instance type is best to perform calculations that include floating point number calculations, graphic processing, and data pattern matching. And the correct answer for this question is option E, accelerated computing. And now we jump on to the question number 36 that says which Amazon EC2 instance type are designed for compute intensive high performance computing or HPC workloads such as computational fluid dynamics, weather forecasting, or molecular dynamics. And let me one more time read all the options: memory optimized, storage optimized, general purpose, compute optimized, accelerated computing, and last one is HPC optimized. And this one is rather easy. You can easily match up this keyword with the options given here. And the correct answer thus is option F, HPC optimized. But friends, please make a note, this is not the exhaustive list of questions that are based on Amazon EC2. There will be loads of questions in the coming episodes as well. But for now, let me give you some documentation for your further self-study. Okay, so this is the documentation from the Amazon itself. First, let's understand the core concept of Amazon EC2. It says that Amazon EC2 provides a wide selection of instance type optimized to fit different use cases, and all these instance types comprise varying combination of CPU, memory, storage, networking capacity, and give you the flexibility to choose the approx mix of resources for your application. Each instance type include one or more instance sizes, allowing you to scale your resources to the requirements of your target workloads. So let's now understand very briefly what are the different 6 types of Amazon EC2. I will just go through the basic definition of each Amazon EC2 instance type. You can read it further. The links are shared in the description box. So first of all, let's start with the general purpose. It says general purpose instance provides a balance of compute, memory, and networking resources and can be used for a variety of diverse workloads. These instances are ideal for applications that use these resources in equal proportions, such as web servers and code repositories. And here, my friends, I just want to highlight one more type of questions that can come. Instead of asking or instead of giving you the definition, as we saw from the question number 31 to 36, AWS can also give you specific usage and can ask you to select the correct EC2 instance type that will exactly fit that business case. So for example, they can ask you to pick the correct EC2 instance type where the workload includes tools, web servers, and code repositories. So my suggestion to you is that along with learning the definitions, also understand the core workloads where these different type of EC2 instances can be used. And with that learning thought in mind, let's move to the compute optimize. And this one says that compute optimize instances are ideal for compute bound application that benefit from the high performance processors. Instance belonging to this category are well suited for batch processing workloads, media transcoding, high performance web servers, high performance computing, scientific modeling, dedicated gaming servers, and ad servers engines, machine learning inference, and other compute intensive applications. So as I just mentioned, along with learning the definition, always learn where these EC2 instances really fit. Now let's jump on to the memory optimized. And this one says that memory optimized instances are designed to deliver fast performance for the workloads that processes large data sets in the memory. Now quickly moving to the accelerated computing. And this one says that these instances use hardware accelerators and coprocessors to perform functions such as floating point number calculation, graphic processing, or data pattern matching more efficiently than possible in software running on CPUs. Now let's jump on to the storage optimized. And storage optimized instances are designed for the workloads that require higher sequential read and write access to very large datasets on a local storage. And then it says they are optimized to deliver tons of thousands of low latency random input-output operations per second to the applications. Moving on with the HPC optimized. And the high performance computing instances are purposed to build to offer the best price performance for running HPC workloads at scale on AWS. So friends, these were the high level definitions for all of the six major instance types. I would really encourage you to read all of these in more details and also learn what are the different type of workloads where these all fit. Okay friends, so now it's time that you get familiar about the various components of AWS global infrastructure. Needless to say, there will be so many questions from this area in the AWS Cloud Practitioner exam. So here comes the question number 37 that says that which component of AWS global infrastructure is made up of one or more discrete data centers that have a redundant power, networking, and connectivity. And your options are AWS region, availability zones, edge location, and the last one is AWS outposts. And the correct answer for this question is option B, availability zone. And just stick around in the video. Let me cover some more questions on AWS global infrastructure, and then we will cover all the documentation. So here comes question number 38 that says which component of the AWS global infrastructure is a physical location around the world where we cluster data centers. And your options are AWS region, availability zone, edge location, and AWS outposts. And the correct answer for this question is option A, AWS region. And friends, in the real exam, this question can be presented in a different way with another definition. So let's check out the another variation of the same question. And here it comes, question number 39, which says which component of AWS global infrastructure consists of a minimum of 3 isolated and physically separate availability zones within a geographic area. Your options once again are AWS region, availability zone, edge location, and lastly AWS outpost. And of course, as I said, this is the variation of the last question, so the answer is also the same, AWS region. And now let's understand the concepts in a little bit more detail with the AWS documentation. And to begin with, let's first understand what is the AWS global infrastructure and what are some key aspects of it. So here you can read that there are 32 launched regions with each multiple availability zones. And now you might be thinking, how many availability zones are there as of now? So there are 102 availability zones. And then there are 550 point of presence and 13 regional edge caches. And not just this, my friends, on this documentation, you can also understand what are the AWS global infrastructure map, which are the countries where they have different regions, and which are the countries or the regions where it is coming soon. So here you can see regions already existing are denoted with this green dot here, but the regions that are coming soon are with these red dots. So here you can see that we have some red dots in Thailand, and then we have red dots, wait a minute, it is in Malaysia. So Malaysia also have a coming soon region as well. Other than that, you can observe all the green dots which are existing regions in AWS global infrastructure. And not just that, there are a lot of other things also given in this documentation. You have 35 local zones, 25 wavelength zones, 245 countries and territories served, And then you also have 115 direct connect locations. And in case you're already thinking why this mammoth global infrastructure is needed, well, that you can read here. So really take out some time to read through this global infrastructure, understand them well, all the nitty-gritties and components of the same. And from here, let me jump on to another documentation that will introduce you to AWS region and availability zones. So first of all, you can see where are all the regions located, what are the upcoming regions, and then my friends, also understand what are AWS edge location. There are many questions that comes from the edge location. We will also cover a lot of questions around the AWS edge location. So please understand this concept very well. Moving on, you can also understand what are the benefits of AWS region, availability zones, and other services. And before I jump on to the next set of questions, I want to give you one more documentation that I thought would be really helpful for you, and that is regions and zones. Here you can understand what exactly are the regions, what are the benefits of the regions. And to start with, each region is designed to be isolated from other regions. This achieves greatest possible fault tolerance and stability. And similarly, my friends, on the same documentation, you can also understand what are the availability zones, local zones, wavelength zones, and AWS outposts. And not to worry, my friends, I've got loads of questions on each of these topics. But then, as I always say, self-study is the best study. And with that, let's jump on to the next question. Question number 40 says that data center used to deliver content fast to your users. Please mind, fast content delivery is being talked here. It is the site that is nearest to your users. You have to pick what is this site. Your options are AWS region, availability zone, edge location, or AWS outpost. And the correct answer to this question is option C, edge location. And guys, many of us are often confused between edge location and CDN, or also known as content delivery network. In fact, sometimes I've seen people interchangeably using both these terms. But surely there is a difference. Keep watching the video as I reveal the difference between the two. So here comes question number 41. It says, family of fully managed solutions delivering AWS infrastructures and services to virtually any on-premises or edge location for a truly consistent hybrid experience. And once again, your options are same, AWS region, availability zones, edge locations, and AWS outposts. And the correct answer for this question is option D, AWS outposts. Coming to the question number 42, it says CloudFront in Amazon is, and your options are availability zones, content delivery network, option C is edge location, and lastly, AWS outposts. And the correct answer for this question is option B. So CloudFront in Amazon is a content delivery network. So this is the documentation on Amazon CloudFront. That is a web service that speeds up distribution of your static and dynamic web content such as HTML, CSS, JavaScript, image files to your users. And please note, CloudFront delivers your content through a worldwide network of data centers called edge locations. So let me put it in my words so that you can understand the difference between Amazon CloudFront and edge locations. So basically, as it is written here, Amazon CloudFront is a web service that helps you deliver the content faster. So in that terms, it is a content delivery network. But then how does CloudFront achieve this? Well, CloudFront uses edge location to deliver the content faster. So this is the difference between edge locations and content delivery network or CloudFront. And friends, I missed to share the documentation for AWS Outpost. So here it is. AWS Outpost is a fully managed service that extends AWS infrastructure, services, APIs, and tools to the customer premises. And by providing local access to the AWS managed infrastructure, AWS Outpost enables customers to build and run application on-premises using the same programming interface as in AWS region, while using local compute and storage resources for lower latency and local data processing needs. Links to all the documentation is right there in the description box. Now let's take a couple of questions on disaster recovery, quite an important topic from exam perspective. So here it comes, question number 43 that says, disaster recovery strategies available to you within AWS can be broadly categorized into which four approaches? And your options are option A, backup and restore, option B, backup and standby, option C, pilot light, option D, cold standby, and then we have warm standby, option F is multi-active, and lastly, multi-site active slash active. So let's check out what are the four correct options. At number one, option A, backup and restore. And then second correct option is option C. Third correct option is option E, warm standby. And finally, at number four, we have option G, multi-site active. Moving on with the question number 44 that says backup with a point in recovery is available through which of the following services and resources? Please note that you have to pick two correct answers. And your options are reserved instances. Option B is Amazon Redshift Snapshot. Option C is AWS Shield. And then at option D, we have Amazon Elastic Block Storage, which is also known as Amazon EBS Snapshots. And lastly, Amazon GuardDuty. And the first correct answer for this question is option B, Amazon Redshift Snapshot. And then we have option D, Amazon Elastic Block Store Snapshots. And now we have question number 45, which says which approach you replicate your data from one region to another and provision a copy of your core workload infrastructure. And your options are backup and restore, pilot light, warm standby, and lastly, multi-site active. And the correct answer for this question is option B, Pilot Lite. And yes, I know that you're looking for the documentation. So here it is, Disaster Recovery Options in the Cloud. And here you can read, disaster recovery strategies available to you within AWS can be broadly categorized into four approaches, ranging from the low cost and allow complexity of making backups to more complex strategies using multiple active regions. And friends, in this documentation, you can read about all the options that we discussed in the questions. For example, we discussed about backup and restore, pilot light, warm standby, multi-site active/active. And interestingly, you can also read about RPO and RTO. In case you do not know, RPO stands for recovery point objective and RTO stands for recovery time objective. So these are some of the disaster recovery strategies given on this documentation. You can read all about backup and restore. Similarly, as we discuss other options, you can read about them as well. AWS services, and similarly, lot more options are given here for you to read. So take some time out from your schedules and read about disaster recovery. Very important aspect in case you really want to build robust application in Amazon AWS. I hope you like the set of 15 questions that we covered today. In case you're not able to understand any question, rewind the video, watch the question again, watch the documentation that I shared and revisit the question. So that was all for today. In case you love our video and love the efforts that we spend to bring the very latest and very well researched questions to you, then please consider liking this video. A single like from you, my friends, really goes a long way for us to reach to a wider audience. So please like the video, subscribe to the channel, press that bell icon and share our videos on all your social media platforms. I will see you in the next video. Till then, stay fit, keep learning, and thanks for watching.